We all know Excel, right? The Microsoft spreadsheet editor that you didn't enjoy learning in school and probably still don't like working with. It may come as no surprise that this software can do much more than just format and change table colors. It actually features the powerful calculation and computation functions that make it so popular. But did you know that you can use Excel as a game engine? I know what you are thinking. There is no way that you can create actual games in a spreadsheet. Well, I was crazy enough to decide to recreate the famous two-dimensional table tennis game in this software. But how am I going to turn static spreadsheet into a video game? Watch it! To do something like this, you'll need two things. The environment with which the user will interact. This is the Excel interface. And then some logical operator who can work with the interface. For that, we have programming language for macros called Visual Basic for Applications. This allows manipulation of tables that is not possible with standard spreadsheet techniques, as well as automation of tasks or data organization. Besides this, you can write any code you want here, which means you are only limited by your imagination and the hardware you are working on, but more on that later. So after I got familiar with the VBA, I had to prepare the environment by modifying the layout of the default table. At first glance, a table is just a collection of cells organized into rows and columns, which is true, but if we adjust their width and height, we can get the smallest addressable elements, pixels. By addressable, I mean that every cell in Excel has its own address, like A1, C5, D4, and so on. We can then refer to this address in a code.
Okay, it's happening!
Now I was ready to set up the scene and draw the first objects, like net, ball, and players. For this, I needed to know how big the object should be in relation to the screen resolution, as I wanted to get as close to the original as possible. Luckily, I found several great sources with very detailed descriptions. It was so detailed that I could have spent the whole week looking for the information I needed. Instead, I asked my good old friend who is the best at answering unknown questions. According to my friend's answer, the pedal size should be 16 pixels in height and 4 pixels in width, and the ball is 2x2 square. Also, he claimed that the original screen resolution was 320 pixels wide and 240 pixels high. Here in my game engine, I could basically get any pixel density I needed, but I decided to reduce it by a half, since you can just zoom in and have a fewer cells that needed to be rendered, which will have a better impact on performance. So after I managed to draw pedals and ball on the screen, it was time to make them move. To create motion, I needed to make a loop that would regularly execute a piece of code with the logic for the object movement. Every iteration of this loop would then create a so-called frame. My first attempt for this loop was to use VBA's built-in onTime method, which schedules a procedure to run at specific time in the future. Thanks to this, I could create a function game loop, which was calling another function and onTime method itself to schedule another run of the game loop in 1 second. And it was moving, but you can spot the problem, right? It was very slow. More precisely, 1 frame per second. You might be thinking that I could simply run this loop more often than 1 second. However, that didn't work, because the VBA functions only have precision to the second. This was quite a problem. What seemed like another option was to use basic loop function, but as I found out, this would create an infinite loop and crash the whole app. Fortunately, there was one more alternative. It turned out that the VBA can directly access some functionalities of the operating system. One of them is a setTimer function, which creates a custom timer, which unlike the built one, has millisecond accuracy. It looked very promising, but soon another blocker appeared. These operating system functionalities are available only on Windows. This is the hardware limitation I mentioned. I tried to find alternatives for Mac OS, but I was unsuccessful. So I had to commit a desperate act of setting up a virtual machine running Windows. When I moved the project there, I noticed some obvious drawbacks in rendering performance, but the loop worked perfectly. Well, now I had to fix another issue. Objects that the ball passed through magically disappeared. This was happening because of the implementation of the ball movement. Basically, the ball object has two variables with the direction coordinates, one for x and one for y axis. These values are added to the current position with every iteration, which creates the coordinates of the next position. When the next position is calculated, the current cell is redrawn to black and the next cell to white, and we move the ball. So you may spot the problem. The previous position is always redrawn to black, regardless of the original color. I fixed that by checking the next cell color, saving it to variable and using for the drawing the previous position of the ball. Then it was time to control the pedals. To do this, I use the onKey method, which runs a specific procedure when a particular key is pressed. However, as I found out later, it cannot detect multiple keys pressed at the same time. Because of that, you would not be able to move both players concurrently. After some research, I found that there is one more handy function of the Windows API called getAsyncKeyState. So I created another function that is called in the game loop and checks what keys have been pressed within a few conditions. Then I needed to fix the flickering of the moving pedal, which was quite annoying. It was caused by the pedal being rendered synchronously, pixel by pixel instead of parallel. It may seem like a finished game at this point, but there was one more important mechanic missing. The ball was basically moving in one direction, which made the game unplayable. To solve this, I had to implement similar logic to the original version, where the ball deflected to different angles based on the hit point of the pedal. According to Wikipedia, the bed should be divided into 8 segments, and each segment would deflect the ball at different angle. In this article, I found slightly different architecture that inspired me. Since my pedals had 8 pixels, I divided them into 5 segments, which give us 10 distinct velocity vectors for the ball. For comparison, the ball in the original Pong had 42 of them. So the segments at the top and bottom are 1 pixel wide and will deflect the ball at the largest angle. This means that it will change the ball's y direction to 2 or minus 2. Another 2 segments are 2 pixels wide and will change the ball's y direction to 1 or minus 1. The last segment is in the middle and it will change the ball's y direction to 0. These changes will of course affect the speed of the ball, meaning the ball will move faster when hit by the edge of the bed and slower when hit near the middle. Now the last thing remaining was the score. I could display the score in the cells outside of the game, which would be quite easy to implement, but that wouldn't be a challenge. Instead, I tried to render numbers on the playground. There were many ways to achieve this, but in the end the solution that worked for me was to create a binary pattern for each number using arrays. Then there is a function that renders the correct number according to the player's score, which is stored in the public variable. Finally, after scoring the goal, I added a little delay and released the ball towards the player who scored. And that's it! Here we have the first ever made Pong in the spreadsheet editor. If you want to try it, just check in the video description where you will find the link to download it. Thank you for watching and for all the support you give me in the form of the comments or likes. See you soon!